This podcast is a member of the Red 5 Network. For more Red 5 Network podcasts and content creators, visit bio.link/red5.
Wait, there's something very weak coming through.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away.
Hello, fellow galactic listeners. I'm Aaron Hoolian, and this is WSTR Galactic Public Access, a Star Wars podcast. Welcome to episode 353. We hope you and yours are well, and with everything crazy going on, we want to continue to be a platform that promotes positivity, life, and hope. Today, we've got a special episode, Star Wars Contributions. We are looking at prolific Star Wars author Michael Stackpole. But before we dive into the treasure trove of literary work, let's see who we got here. Mr. Todd Hoffman, welcome back.
What is up, my friend? How are you?
I am doing A-okay.
And are you feeling better?
Yes, I'm not gripping my stomach, laying down on the couch, hoping the suffering will end.
can you rip a ears off a Gundark?
Close.
Okay. Close so enough. We're getting close. We're getting close. Yeah.
Yeah. Good. Yeah. We've got Carla joining us in a moment. She's going to be coming in hot. Heather's got the night off. So Todd, why don't you go ahead and tease that news?
I shall. We are pulling for you is the first one. On right. And then off again is the second one. And then finally, okay. Skull Island is the last one.
Oh, my God.
Yes, yeah. So, but it's not what you think. Right. Yeah.
Oh, it's not calm.
No. You're not supposed to give it away, Aaron.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Yeah. Oh, hi, Carla.
Well, hi.
Thanks for stopping by. You're here just in time because we're about to start our main topic.
And now for our feature presentation.
Here we go.
Fanfare. All right,
take it away, Todd.
Okay. If you're a first-time listener or a longtime WSTR supporter, we started this series, I believe, about 2 years ago, where we take a look at some of the lesser-known people that help contribute to the Star Wars universe. And today, we're going to be looking at Star Wars author Michael Stackpole. So right off the bat, I'm just, you know, we were talking a little bit before, but Aaron should have a love affair with Stackpole here because he's got D&D roots. He's got roots back. Yeah. So Stackpole is essentially, if we look at the old Wikipedia here, we're looking there. He's a science fiction and fantasy author, but he's best known for his Star Wars books, which obviously we'll be talking about in a little bit, but also BattleTech books, which is like super nerdy. So yeah. So anyways, he got his kind of claim to fame in the early 80s or like, yeah, 78, early 80s, where he started working for Coleco, which is like Coleco Vision, if you're really nerdy about the games back in the day. But
ancient history.
Yes. That's where he met a couple other gentlemen at a pinball convention. So this guy, you know, he's a gamer.
He's got old nerd school. Cred.
Yeah. He's got super nerd.
That's a thing.
Yeah. That's a thing. Yes. So he worked for Coleco and then met this other guy, Rick Loomis. And essentially he developed a role playing game called Mercenaries, Spies, and Private Eyes. And the company was called Flying Buffalo, which is fantastic. It's great. Then he started working on computer role-playing games. One was called Wasteland. That came out in 1988 from Interplay, yes. Which I don't even think Interplay is a thing now. But back in the day, they were producing a lot of PC gaming, man. So, yeah. So that's that. But, so this is where, like, this is prime time for me, man, because I think I was scarred, like, emotionally, physically, I don't know. But D&D was a cult in the 80s, man. Yeah. So there's this
sick panic.
Yes, exactly. So the big push was not only the satanic thing, but then teen suicide was like the big deal.
Yeah.
So there's this girl called Patricia Poyne.
That and rock music.
Yeah, rock music. Yeah.
Yes.
Was so basically there was like this whole push for Dungeons & Dragons driving people to suicide. And so Stackpole was one of his first articles about role-playing games and the misinformation from the media. You're telling me the media provides misinformation? I find that hard to believe. But seriously,
fake news.
Yeah, seriously. In the 80s,
people would go on the internet and tell lies.
But this is before the internet, so everything was printed was real. It was real.
Nothing is new under the sun.
Yes, exactly. So I love this one. He publishes in 1982 the article titled "Devil Games?" Nonsense! Exclamation point.
That's a great title.
I know. So essentially, he debated that he went on the radio, probably, you know, in modern times, this would have been a podcast, but he went on the radio and basically debated about the statistics that were pulling because the rate of general teen suicide was found, the percentage of role playing committing suicide was actually lower than those who are not gamers. So basically, what we're saying is like, you're saying people that play D&D are committing suicide because it's occultish and all that, but the stats weren't matching up. It was facts, but they were slaying the other way, you know, trying to say that, you know, D&D's from the devil. He also published an article called The Truth About Role-Playing Games in the 1989 book Satanism in America. So yeah, I don't know what that book's about, but I guess it's about Satanism, but maybe, I don't know. So anyways, yeah, so that was a big deal. I mean, like,
it was.
Yeah.
It seems like really tame in comparison to today, but yeah, people were freaking out about all this sort of thing. And he had just about enough of that nonsense.
He was like, this is kleflui.
I had about enough of you.
Yeah. Well, for me, it was like the big thing, like rock music, like if you play the record backwards and D&D.
Oh, yeah.
Like my mom was like,
Judas Priest went to court for that.
Yes. Yeah. My mom was like, straight up, you're not playing D&D. It's from the devil. And I was like, okay. But yeah, like, it's so funny because like, you see that a little bit in Stranger Things too. I'm like, yeah, this is pretty accurate. Back in the 80s, but yeah. So that was kind of like,
still don't know I play.
What?
Oh yeah,
that's a good secret to have, I guess. Huh?
I know it. That's a conversation topic. I don't want to touch.
Mom, I'm a dungeon master.
Mom, Dad.
Yeah, not only do you play, but you're a DM.
Yeah.
And it's not direct messaging, Mom. I'm a dungeon master. You know.
Yeah. Oh man.
Oh my gosh, boy. Yeah, but that was a thing. That was like a real big thing, especially that 80s, man. I tell you what. Okay. So then he worked with Interplay to do Bard's Tale 3, Necromancer, a couple Star Trek games. Yeah, so he was kind of, that's where like his roots was in really that realm. So then in 1986, his first novel was a fantasy story that he was a short story, but basically he loved the fantasy stuff. And then he worked on Battletech. So the Battletech universe was kind of a big deal back then. And he worked on a couple trilogies there for Battletech. And he actually did some Battletech animated series too, which is it tied into the animated series, which was kind of cool. Yeah, so he did a bunch of that. And then, so you kind of fast forward a little bit, and he was selected to write several novels in the Star Wars universe from Bantam Books. He also wrote several comics based in the Star Wars universe for Dark Horse Comics. But so he he basically did the X-Wing series, which was a series of books that came out in the early or late 90s. He did the core collaborated with Aaron Alston, which we also covered a while back. But yeah, so he's the first one. He wrote X-Wing Rogue Squadron, and then Wedge's Gamble, the Krytos Chap, Back to War, and then Asar's Revenge. And then we'll talk about this in a minute, but I, Jedi was one that he wrote, which was a unique book told from like a first person perspective from a Jedi named Coran Horn. And we'll talk about him in a minute. And it might be like my top five. It's like in my top five Star Wars books of all times. It's amazing.
Oh my God.
Our boy Mark Thompson just published a new audiobook for this book.
Oh
yeah,
it all comes together
like perfect timing, like stars aligning.
Look at that.
Yeah. And then he also published two books in the ridiculously long New Jedi Order series. He did Dark Tide 1 Onslaught and Dark Tide 2 Ruin. Yeah, so he's kind of been all over the place. He also did a little Mech Warrior. Yeah, so but ooh, he literally quite
love me some Mech
one
Warrior.
Two three four He did like at least, let's see here, 12 books in the Battletech series. Did a little World of Warcraft.
Looking at a list of like all his books.
Yes.
I don't think the man stops writing.
Yes. He was pretty. He's been publishing a lot. It looks like it's slowed down a little bit. And he even wrote a Conan the Barbarian. I mean, this guy's doing a lot of
dumb. Yeah.
But, you know, again, we're a Star Wars podcast here, so let's circle back. Have you guys read any of his books?
I don't think so.
I think I read...
Like, I'm familiar with the titles, but...
Yeah.
I think I read one of the X-Wing books way back as a youngin', maybe like middle school, because like the library by where I lived, there's like the fantasy sci-fi section.
Yeah.
And I remember just like walking past that, and there's this one section where it's just like Stackpole. And it's just like just like a bunch of them.
Right. Yeah.
I think I read one of the X-Wing books, but I could not tell you anything about what happened. It was way too long ago.
So long ago. Yes. Okay. So you, Carla, you're probably hard no, huh?
I mean, like I said, some of the titles, obviously, like the X-Wing Rogue Squadron and the iJet. Like, I have a whole shelf of Legends books.
Legends, yes.
That I just haven't read yet.
What?
Like, I'm staring at them.
What?
Yeah.
You're one of those people that have, like, a bookshelf and you haven't read the books on the shelf?
No. Well, a lot of them were given to me by my aunt. Oh. Because,
yeah, you know, your aunt is cool, so...
Yeah, so it's just a matter of finding the time to read them.
go get one of them.
Finish the Old Republic books.
Yeah, I mean,
pull it off the shelf, or you'll never read it.
That's right. Yeah.
True.
Yeah. Yeah, I got a couple. I mean, I pretty much got all the. I got all the X-Wing books. So.
Oh, I think you both turned around right at the same time.
Aaron,
we use the force.
Aaron, you got just a black cloth back.
Yeah, I got nothing.
You're like, you know what?
For those
you
just listening to the podcast, we are all like, Carla's looking behind the camera, off camera at the bookshelf. Todd is looking straight behind him at his bookshelf.
Yeah.
So I joined in. And I've got nothing to look at because there's a wall here.
I think like any, you know, like a Zoom or Teams meeting, you should just have like a fake background of like this.
Oh, yeah.
Like, just like books, just like great, you know, you know, mahogany shelves. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Like the Beauty and the Beast library.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes. Exactly. Well, if if you're in for, you're in for a treat, because he is a really good writer. I love his writing style. So definitely, if you're looking for a good start in the Legend series, the X-Wing series is fun. It's fun. It really, Wedge Antilles is kind of the leader of Rogue Squadron, because, you know, Luke's doing his thing. And it's a really great book, a great series of books. And if you like X-Wings, if you like flying, you like Top Gun, all that fun stuff. And yeah, it's really, really good. But I do want to talk about two characters he created that are really, really good in the Legend series that I thought we could spend just a little bit of time on, because yeah, they're just cool. So the first one has a fun name. It's Soontir Fel. Okay. And he is a Krillian pilot, which we love our Krillians. But Carla, this one should ring a bell, because he's one of the 501st TIE fighter pilots that can be. Yes. Yes.
He's a CRL.
He's a CRL. So he was a TIE fighter pilot, and he was essentially, it says, Fel was exiled to a lackluster 181st Imperial Fighter Wing, which he revived, eventually gaining his command to the title of Baron of the Empire. Winning Fel a reputation as Empire's most deadly pilot, and the 181st is the most elite starfighter unit. So basically, the 181st is the equivalent of Rogue Squadron in the Star Wars Legends series. But yeah, so here's the twist. The twist. We love the twist. Fel met and married a famous actress called Wince Starflare, who he discovered was actually the sister of Rebel ace Wedge Antilles. So that's right, folks.
Soap opera nonsense.
It's a soap opera. So basically, Fel
is, Days of Our Lives.
Yes, Fel is the mirror image of just how Aaron and I were in sync when we turned our heads around at the same time. Like Fel and Wedge Antilles are like both opposites. And again, Wedge is from Corellia. Fell's from Corellia, so you got that little thing going on. So yeah, it's really good. And again, as you know, TIE fighter pilots, they don't got the shields, they don't got all the Empire kind of skimps and all the necessities you need. You're just basically in a tin can, and they're like, hey, we got 20 lined up behind you, so you're fine.
You get good.
So yeah, so that's kind of, but to have the title of Baron of the Empire, it's a pretty tall title to have, especially when you're a TIE fighter pilot. Yeah. So anyways, it's kind of fun. There's a little, Okay. So he joins his brother-in-law Antilles in Rogue Squadron, serving the New Republic faithfully. But shortly thereafter, Fel was recaptured by Asard. Now, Asard is like this girl Imperial Moff Tarkin kind of character. She's kind of mean and nasty. Okay, and sent to Grand Admiral Thrawn. I know him. There, Thrawn showed Fel the myriad threats awaiting the galaxy in the unknown regions. And Fel agreed to serve Thrawn's Empire of the Hand, who is Mara Jade, fighting against warlords and would be invaded beyond the knowledge of the galactic civilization. So, yeah. So Fel raised his family, surrounded by hardship, but once again making contact with the galaxy at the large during the hoax proclaiming Thrawn's return when the Yuuzhan Vong war broke out. Yeah. So anyways, there's a lot there. And maybe we'll have to go back to Fel in a little bit. But he had some kids. They had lots of kids. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like 6 kids.
Lots of kids. And yeah, so there's a lot of fells. But yeah, the 181st is really one of the coolest things. Yeah, and he's part of the 501st. That's legit, man. So that...
Yeah, I was looking at the costume.
Yeah.
So it's basically like a TIE pilot, except they've got red stripes down the sides.
It got red
and it's
stripes?
A gray flak vest.
Yes.
Ooh.
Yeah. Here, let me...
They've got a little flare to them.
He got a little flare.
Yeah, let's see if we go... Where's my fell? Fell. Oh, that. Yeah, he's kind of kitty.
Oh,
kitty. Like, get out of here. You get. Yeah, so he has, there's three.
Well, there's specifically like Baron Fell's uniform. And then there's a like generic 181st.
Yeah. So
I don't know how they're different.
Well, let me tell you.
They literally look the same to me. Yeah, but
So again, the regular TIE fighter pilot is on black, but here he's got like a little gray and silver to him.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's got a little.
But that's the generic one.
Yeah. 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 So he's got this.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the generic one. You got patches and yeah, all that fun stuff. And all kinds of fun stuff. Injection hardness. No one injects in.
Look at those standards. Look at all those
okay,
standards.
So then we have the dress uniform gray. Fun. This is pretty fancy. This is pretty gray.
Sharp.
Sharp. Yeah, look at this guy. Good job, Jason Poulin. You look sharp. Ooh, see, look at the Jolly Roger one. That's fun. So it's tunic, like a tunic, dark gray. Rank, yeah. Code cylinders. Gotta have some code cylinders. Like, where do they come up with these pants? Little flare.
The jodpers.
I don't know, but they're great.
Gotta have some jodpers. Okay, so that's that.
Aren't they used here, in, like, equestrian stuff?
Yeah.
There he is. Look at this guy. That's
see, Baron. I don't know what the difference is between that one and the other one.
Well, they got so the silver painting on the top of the helmet is unique because it's all black. The silver and the grill is silver and his little silver. Yep. And then he's got like that. He's basically got almost like a X-Wing flight vest. Don't tell him he's a rebel, but
kind of.
Yeah. And then the ejection harness thing is like a silverish.
Well, that's not because regular TIE pilots don't have that.
Oh, well, yeah, they don't eject. Yeah. So it says unique center Mohawk stripe with connecting box or diamond pattern. Silver teeth. Yeah. Like silver. We got a little bit more silver, okay. A little more bling. Gotta have a baklava.
So
yeah, a gray flak vest is what's unique about that. And yeah.
Yeah, like the harness, the like your standard TIE pilots.
Yeah.
Like original trilogy, they don't have.
Yeah, because they don't eject. Harness. There's no ejection.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is called an ejection harness. It's gray elastic with gray webbing. Fun.
Actually, that makes sense. Like, it is more aligned with, like, the Rebel pilot costume.
Yeah. Which, right, the Rebel pilots have that. Your face, okay. Hair, maybe dark brown, black, gray, or a mixture of black and gray. Salt and pepper. Neatly trimmed hair. Styly. Okay. Goatee is neatly trimmed. Okay. Wow. Do they have that?
That'd be cool. Like,
Carla, do they have that? Like, you have to show if it's a face character, it has to be a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I know. I mean, we can go down
a rabbit hole.
A rabbit hole here.
Yeah.
But I think Rebel Legion's a little bit more
chill.
Like, yeah, not so much like more so with hair color. Like, they can't tell you you can't be Princess Leia because you have blonde hair.
Still
be Princess Leia, yeah, as long as it's a net, like, it has to be a natural hair color.
Oh.
Yeah.
Can't be,
you can't be rocking, like, pink? Hot pink buns.
Yeah, hot. Right. What?
You know?
Yeah, I gotcha.
I don't know. Yeah. It's like certain things are a little more
chill on,
strict about than others. I think the 501st is very much like, no, like,
right,
this is what you have to do.
Right, right.
Kind of a thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I gotcha. So there you go. The Baron.
That's big though. Like, you wrote this book and then it's like your character has like an official costume, you know?
Yeah.
That's cool to me.
Yeah. Yeah, because like he's describing the character obviously in the book, and there's enough there that probably, I'm sure, there's an appearance of Fel in some Dark Horse comic, and they're like, okay,
yeah,
because
that's the thing. It's like, especially with the book characters, because you think, well, how do you get a costume reference if there's no pictures?
Thank you.
Like, a lot of people were actually, I was quite annoyed. Again, here we go.
We're going down a rabbit hole.
When the Battlefront 2 novel came out,
ish,
with, you know, Iden, Versio, and
yes,
and crew. Mm-hmm. So originally there were 4 members. If you read the book, there were 4 members. Yes. It was her, Hask, the hell's the other guy's name?
That guy.
Dell. And then her name was
Cindy.
I think her name was Sin or something. C-I-N or something like that.
Oh, man.
And I remember
pulled that out of my butt.
I'll confirm. But yeah, when the book came out, you know, everybody was, you know, they started throwing out like the costume for Iden and all this stuff.
Yeah.
And they had started working up a CRL for the 4th member. And then they were like, well, there's not enough references. And it's like, she's literally wearing almost the same thing as everybody else.
So wait, the girl?
So wow. Yeah, there's no CRL for her,
wow,
the 4th. And I was so mad. The reason why I was so mad was because I was like, all right, this is pretty like badass, right? Like,
yeah,
the whole get up and stuff. But in the book, she's described as being like petite, 4'11" build. And I'm just like, finally. And then they're like, never mind.
So mad.
And she carries, because she's like the sniper of the group. I'm like, yo, let's go. Let's go.
You like those sniper rifles.
Little gal with a big gun. Let's go.
She packing some heat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dang, you should make a CRL.
Sin, it's Sin, S-E.
Yeah.
Yeah, S-E-Y-N.
That was it.
Yeah, so if Iden, Gideon, Sin, and Del is, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to be salty with you.
Salty.
Because like both Gideon and Del are pretty much the same costume.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know about this. I'm very sad now. Well, that's a story.
All these really cool female women characters, you know, in Star Wars that they just decide, you know, just not going to do that. Happy Women's History Month, everybody.
What if we just don't?
Oh my gosh. What have we done? We triggered Carla. That's what we did.
I don't know. It brought up the thought of it.
Yeah. I'm sorry. But yeah, maybe we can talk about Sin some other time. There you go. Yeah, so I think it's pretty cool. Like I said, one of my buddies, Ted, in the Midwest, he has a Fel TIE fighter, and it looks really cool because it's like, it's just different. You know, it's just fun. It's a little little color, a little splash to the normal black TIE fighter pilot that gets called Darth Vader more than you would like to know. Hey, aren't you Darth Vader? Yeah. Yep, I am. Okay, so back to Stackpole. There's another character that is featured, and that is Coran Horn. And he's a pretty interesting character. Again, Corellia is a hotspot. Maybe Stackpole just really liked Corellia because Coran Horn is from Corellia, but he's kind of like, he's part of like a security force investigator. He's kind of like a CSI kind of guy for Corellia. But then he doesn't know this, but he has force sensitivity, and it kind of comes out later. He's very much a late bloomer. And that's kind of the book, I, Jedi, is him kind of discovering that. And like I said, it's told from a first person perspective. So it's pretty interesting. Yeah. So if you want to read more about that, I would highly recommend the new, you know, Mark Thompson audiobook for Jedi that you could check out and find out all about him. But yeah, so he kind of has this kind of more of a military practical background, but then kind of finds out that, hey, I got some Jedi stuff in here, man. And he interplays, like, that's the other thing, like there's some interconnection. Coran is also in the X-Wing series, so there's like a lot of interplay there. And he marries this girl Miramax Tarek, and it's fun because Booster Tarek is a really fun character in the Legends series. So there's just a lot of interplay with these characters, and they kind of grow on you if you read the Legends books. So yeah, he just kind of interplays a lot of that in his stories. But yeah, like I said, I Jedi is like, it's good. It's real good. So, but like most Legend stuff, his appearance kind of changes a little bit, and so they use, like, well, he's in disguise. It's not, his appearance is not very consistent, so a lot of what you see in Dark Horse is a little bit different sometimes in later versions. And yeah, it's just kind of all over the place. But like in I, Jedi, it's more of like kind of blonde goatee, kind of trim goatee. But in like when he's with Wedge and stuff as a pilot, he's kind of more dark haired. And yeah, so anyways, little inconsistency there from his appearance. And in fact, Stackpole they use him as a model for one of the cards from the Decipher game. Yeah. So he's got he became his own character, which is great. But yeah, super, super fun. And Coran Horn plays a pivotal role in the Yuuzhan Vong War. And so, yeah, he just becomes a really strong character later in the books. So we will probably do some Imperial inspection on him at some times, because we haven't done a lot of Legends characters. We have to, do that. So, but yeah, so again, like back in the Dark Ages, when there was no Star Wars movies, Stackpole was writing a lot of books. So that's kind of the takeaway from Stackpole, is just like really developing the X-Wing series and developing a lot of good characters that are used throughout the Legends, which is always good. Similar to the grandfather, Timothy Zahn, you know, we have Mara Jade and Thrawn are like his two like really, really big contributions, obviously. But again, Fel and Coran Horn are like two of the biggest ones that Stackpole, you know, contributes to Star Wars.
Surprised he hasn't been like involved in any new stuff, if he's written so many.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I don't know, like, if something happened there. I'm not sure. His name got dropped in the news. Actually, it was Brad from Scarif Scuttlebutt. Like, he talked to Stackpole and was wondering about Patty Jenkins' Rogue Squadron and if he was consulted. And he was consulted and just basically said, like, yeah, we had a discussion about it, just really talked about, you know, how he approached it and how he approached the material and that kind of thing. But yeah, it's just he kind of built him and Aaron Alston kind of built that all out with the X-Wing Squadron. So there you go. Yeah, but he hasn't been like Alan D. Foster, who we talked about a couple weeks ago, where he wrote the first Star Wars book. And he actually did some recent novelizations. You know, he did the Force Awakens novelization. He's kind of the beginning and still doing some new stuff with Disney. So, but yeah, Stackpole hasn't done a Star Wars book in quite a bit. So
yeah,
maybe something in the works. I don't know. So there you have it. Michael Stackpole.
Awesome. Yeah, I'm going to have to check this guy out.
Check him out, dude.
I Jedi, you would recommend?
Yes, please, and thank you.
It's just like a one-off?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Sweet.
Yeah, so that's where it's like, obviously he's bringing in characters that have been established in Legends, but it's not enough to like turn you off to the story. I mean, the story's pretty self-contained, and obviously, there's a little Luke in there as well, so it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Sweet.
Yes, yes, yes.
All right. But with that, we're going to go ahead and move to Intercepted Imperial Transmissions.
Senator! Intercepted Imperial Transmission, Mom.
What?
I know, it's been a long time coming.
What?
Gosh.
Dipping into the archives. We got a couple in the queue.
We are. Yeah. We are. This one comes to us from our pal, Ro, and talking a little bit about the Bad Batch.
All right, here we go.
Hey, guys, this is Ro from the Scarif Scuttlebutt podcast. You just tweeted, drop your thoughts on the trailer for the last season of the Bad Batch. So here I am. I just watched it, I think it was earlier today. I was preoccupied with people talking to me about another subject yesterday, but that's another story. I thought it was great. I know we were all waiting for that trailer to drop, and it could not have come at a better time. I think people are starving for Star Wars, and Lucasfilm is trickling in the Star Wars for us fans. So that's great. It looked fantastic. I think, you know, I've fallen in love with this show. One that I wasn't really excited the very first time they made the announcement that they were going to make Bad Batch into a series. But holy smokes, the characters really, you know, locked in for me. The writing was great. And I almost feel like, you know, this show is a lot better for me than a lot of the recent Star Wars live action shows. So it'll be great to see the gang back for one last mission. We've got some really wonderful surprises in there and some questions. It wouldn't be a Star Wars show without questions. So I'm looking forward to it. I'm wondering what else everybody else thinks about this, but we'll be listening. And that's about it. Keep up the good work. May the Force be with you. And that's the Scuttlebutt.
All right. Thank you, Ro.
Month ago or two.
I was gonna wait. Yeah. How long ago was that?
Well, we have some archives. It's okay. It's okay.
A backlog.
Yeah. Well, I mean,
bringing that up with us being like knee deep in the season already.
Yes. Yeah. They just dropped a double episode yesterday, so we're already halfway through. Yeah, so, we're getting close. But, yeah, I think it's exciting. It's super well animated. The music's great. But you're going to have to wait till June until we talk about more Bad Batch. So,
yes. That's a long time, Todd.
Well, if we don't, you know, we're just kind of setting the tone, like, hey man, you know, got to mature, you know, kind of sit on him for a little bit, and you know, gives Carla and Heather a little time to.
Yeah.
You can watch it while you're reading I, Jedi.
Yeah, that's right. And all your X-Wing books. Well, thanks, Ro. We play our our voicemail whenever we get to it. So
whatever. You know.
All right. With that, it's time we move to News of the Week.
And now, the Star Wars News of the Week.
All right, Todd, take it away.
Oh, okay. Yes. Okay. All right. This is coming from Scripps News. Clayton Sandell. He was a longtime ABC reporter and now doing some independent stuff. But basically, the title is Mother of Star Wars Child Actor Details His Mental Health Struggles. And then it says Jake Lloyd, who played a young Anakin Skywalker, disappeared from the public eye after being cast in The Phantom Menace at 8 years old. So I'm not going to get too deep, but this is kind of coming around. We're close to the 25-year mark of Star Wars Episode One, The Phantom Menace. And Jake Lloyd was chosen out of 3,000 actors to play Anakin Skywalker. And he's just so cute and adorable. But then, unfortunately, Jake started having trouble in high school and essentially was, he just could not kind of keep it together and was then diagnosed with kind of a bipolar disorder. And eventually it was turned into schizophrenia and unfortunately had a couple breakdowns, and it was kind of a dark path for him for a little bit. But his mom is saying that things have turned around and he's getting better and getting the help he needs. And so it's just a very in-depth article of, and if you want to read that, it's coming from Scripps News. But essentially there's a lot of rumors going around, and the mom basically said Star Wars did not drive him into this period. In fact, unfortunately, his dad also suffered from this. And so some of that mental illness is linked genetically. And so he was kind of predisposed. But she also says, like, she shielded him from a lot of the news and the hate that was happening back then for him. So he's still... at the end here, it says that he still loves Star Wars. He enjoys watching the new shows. And he's just getting better mentally, which is really a great and healthy place to be. So, yeah.
Yeah, I don't have much to say about it, except, like, I guess the popular story that rose up after he kind of disappeared was that he was, like, bullied out of Hollywood and acting altogether, which is not true.
No.
Very believable, though. Very plausible, because there's, like, a handful of child actors who have ever made it out okay. And it seems like the rest just had horrible things happen to them. So,
yes,
made sense, but in this case was not true. And so there's that. But also, it's just worth a read as far as, like, understanding someone's story and struggles and how they kind of cope with that. And I would recommend it. Go ahead and give it a read.
Yeah, I think too, like, just everything that came out with Ahmaud Best and really, like, Jake Lloyd, you know, there's a lot of, and even Hayden, you know, like, there's just a lot of bad blood back then. And now that the time is past and a little healing, I think, a little bit. But Jake, unfortunately, just because of his situation, I mean, he hasn't seen Ahmaud, got to experience that a little bit at Celebration, you know, and Hayden's seen a little bit resurgence. And I would really love to see a point where Jake Lloyd can you know, go more in the public and get some of that love and attention that, you know, like, again, George wrote this stuff. Can't really say it. He did the best he can at 8 years old. Mm. Yeah. I just feel like, yeah, it's that rumor was pretty heavy about like Star Wars broken, you know, and it's like, well, there's a lot. This article really goes into the depths of what really happened. And I think it's important to understand what the truth is versus what is told in the media. See, it goes back to the media, you know? So
it doesn't make.
Don't forget.
Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, don't forget, he was also Jamie in Jingle All the Way. Oh. Very underrated movie, by the way.
I love Jingle That's All the Way.
True.
It's so good.
Yes.
Jamie. I'm Turbo Man.
Turbo Man.
Jamie, I'm your father.
So good.
Yeah. Phil Hartman, so good in that film.
Oh, man. Oh, and Sinbad, too.
Man.
Like, it's so good.
It's bad in a sec.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Guys, you're sitting down. Yes, you're sitting down. Are you ready? It's coming from Collider.com. Patty Jenkins claims she's back working on Rogue Squadron.
What?
And she says she's writing the script right now.
Right now?
Right now. She's at home writing the script. Patty Jenkins claims she signed a new deal with Lucasfilm and Disney to write and direct Rogue Squadron. Jenkins said project initially paused for work on Wonder Woman 3, which is no longer in production because James Gunn came in and said, bye. In an earlier statement, the director said Rogue Squadron would honor her late father, who was a fighter pilot. So, you know, just if you've been hiding under a bush or whatever, but basically this was first announced in 2020. We have a little shtick where she's in a Rogue Squadron fighter pilot. She's roller skating. It's great. And it's off again, on again, it's off again. Somehow she's returned. Patty
I'll believe it when it's on the movie screen.
I am with you, Carla.
Yeah.
Because, like, did you see recently the Mandalorian game got canceled?
Yes.
There was a Mandalorian game?
Yeah, for Respawn. Well,
yeah. It was going to be like a first-person shooter Mandalorian type game. Mm-hmm. And yeah, that got canceled.
Mm-hmm.
And like the recent Battlefront remaster is garbage. And
what?
Yeah.
Whoa,
yeah, people can't play games because like the servers suck and
it's garbage.
The performance is not great. Like they used AI to upscale a bunch of textures, but then they didn't compress them at all. So it's like a 47 gigabyte download, but they didn't upscale like the heads up display textures. So that's all blurry. It's bad. It's so bad.
Oh, you just spoke a different language there.
It sucks. It's not worth $30 is all you need to know.
Wow.
Yeah, I'm salty.
Oh, jeez.
Just came right out of the gate. The remaster is garbage.
Well, like
we're talking about Patty Jenkins. See, like now first with Carla, Sin, and now you're talking about Battlefront 2.
My point being, like,
yes,
every little Star Wars leak we get like this, where it's like something Star Wars is coming, it's like, I'll believe it when I see it. Because, like,
literally,
movies, with TV shows, with games, like, it's all the same.
My only reaction is Anchorman when he's, you know, at the beginning goes, I don't believe you. And then he lights the cigarette.
Yeah.
It's my only reaction to everything now. I don't believe you.
I just, this is what I don't understand. And this is what's baffling me about Lucasfilm. most of this news that we get about the films, about it, never comes from KK. It like barely comes from her, you know? And when it does, like when she's looking lovingly into Ewan's eyes and says, "Do you want to play Obi-Wan Kenobi?" He's like, "Yes, yes, I do." Then it's like 8 years later it happens. It's like,
she's like,
"Well, that was because of COVID."
All right, fine. I'll give up. You know,
still, that's what, I mean, 4 of those years.
Like,
come on now.
But like, could you imagine if they had done that and then it never came to fruition?
Ooh.
Oh my God.
But you got to remember, I think there was still a couple years before COVID. I don't know. Now I might be going on a tangent. Anyways.
Well, because that was like summer of, end of the summer of 2019. Because I remember there was watching that sitting in my hotel in Italy. Oh. And I was like, like, I have a very distinct memory of watching that. Yeah.
Actually, it was 2017. I was in Italy. I remember watching that too, but like, there was something, but remember all the news and hubbub was like, it was going to be a movie. Then they decided it was going to be a TV thing. And then there was something about they landed Deborah Chow, but then they had to rewrite it because they were trying to figure it out. You know, there was a lot of.
But was that all before they dropped the, like, bringing him out was, and
then they brought him out and then he had to play face and be like, "We're working on it," you know, like for. Oh my gosh!
I just saw there was an interview with him and Mary, his wife, Mary Winstead.
Is that his name?
Because I think it was one of the late night talk shows.
Yeah.
She was talking about like Ahsoka season 2 is like being written and stuff.
Uh-huh.
And then they turn to Ewan and they're like, "Obi-Wan season 2? And he's like, "I don't have any news for you."
Well, you know, because they were in talks for years and he had to always play it down. Like, he had to play it down. Then he was so happy.
Yeah.
He was so happy to do it. And then it was a long time ago, guys. I think it had to be. I'm looking up YouTube right now. I got to.
Probably like when Disney bought Lucasfilm?
It was
that far back?
I don't think it was that far back.
D23. It was D23 4 years ago. So, yeah, it was a while ago, dude.
What is time, anyway? Just an idea.
Yeah. The last 4 years have been like, I don't know.
Just a black hole.
Honestly, okay, now it's coming off full circle. This was the same one. This is the same D23 that they announced Rogue Squadron.
Oh.
Well, there you go.
Ooh.
There you go.
Well,
I have nothing against Patty Jenkins. I mean, the first Wonder Woman is better than the second Wonder Woman. But, you know, I feel bad for her because she really, it's a passion project for her. And they, you know, DC didn't know what they were doing and basically said, bye, Felicia. So. Hmm.
The second one was really bad.
It was horrible and it had Pedro in it. You can't.
I know. Oh, whoa. I don't like talking about him in that movie. With the blonde hair and the no.
The whole problem with that movie is that, well, there's a lot of problems, but first of all, you have two villains. Never a good thing to have two villains. And they have this kind of. The they have two beginnings of that movie. Like, there's a whole, where she live? Where's one Wonder Woman live?
London, the museum?
No.
Oh, like her home
world.
Right?
Yeah.
Oh, the mascara.
Yeah.
Mascara, yes. So they have that whole sequence, like, where she's, but then you have the whole sequence, like, in the mall.
Oh, I shut that movie out of my brain, and now it's coming back. Why'd you do this, Todd?
Well, but I'm just saying, you should have started with the mall. The mall's fantastic. The whole mall scene is great. Yeah. That's where you should have started. You shouldn't have done this whole young Wonder Woman thing. It's like two beginnings, then you got two villains. It's dumb. It's dumb. You shouldn't have Christina Wiig as, No.
Who's excited for Rogue Squadron?
Hey, if she consults Michael Stackpole again, that would be really, really good. See? So, isn't it great when the stars align? I'm like, hey, let's talk about Michael Stackpole, and then Patty Jenkins is back! She's back!
There you go.
Look at that.
I know. Okay.
What else we got?
And finally, Star Wars Jedi director starts new studio with a bunch of ex-Respawn talent. Stig Asmussen reveals giant skull.
Whoa.
Yeah. Game director Stig Asmussen, who left Respawn Entertainment last fall. Actually, he left right when Survivor dropped. He's like, bye, I'm out.
Hi, Felicia.
Bye. So he he's done Jedi Fallen Order, Jedi Survivor, multiple God of War games. So basically, no surprise here. What this sounds like, every game described as a dedicated to building gameplay driven, story immersed action adventure games set in captivating worlds. It's a AAA single player focused action adventure powered by Unreal Engine 5. That's all we got.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But quite a few game developers. We got Epic Games, Riot Games, Rocksteady Studios, technical director from Star Wars Jedi Survivor, our director who worked on Fortnite, Valorant, Leagues of Legends, God of War. Another person, lead producer from Fortnite and design director from Star Wars Jedi Games, and an animation director from Epic Games. So it sounds like he's got his Avengers assembled, and ready to go, and hopefully
putting together an initiative.
Cool, yeah. And again, this announcement comes after a massive layoffs from EA, which, again, as Aaron just eloquently said, Respawn in development first-person shooter set in the Star Wars universe, which was supposed to be a Mandalorian game, has been axed because of these recent layoffs in EA, which also affected Respawn. So he got out of there, like, I got to make my own thing, which is kind of cool. So, yeah, I mean, again, it's more of an announcement of the studio than a true game announcement, but at least it definitely sounds like they have a lot of talent there.
Yeah, again, one of those, like, I'll believe it when I see it kind of things, but it's nice that, like, all these layoffs happen and someone's like, hey, come work for me.
Hey, come work for me.
So hope they're all doing okay.
Well, and two, with that, you don't have the bureaucracy of the big studios like EA. So if you got somebody, again, if you're passionate about what you love and you do it well, it's going to show in the product. So I have high hopes for this giant skull studio.
Hey, Stig, get the Star Wars license. No one's using it.
Right. make the games we want, please.
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 Oh.
That is all the news of the week.
All the news that's fit to print.
Fit to print.
That means it's time for Cantina Chat. All right, the part of the show where we talk about everything geeky and weird going on with our lives. Carla, what's so geeky and weird about you?
Oh, not too much. I mean, the biggest thing for me this week was we went up to New Haven, Connecticut over the weekend. We joined our...
New Haven?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
We joined our fellow Legion friends up in the... for Connecticut Garrison and Camino Base is their Rebel Legion chapter, and Kessel Base is their Saber Guild group. But what was cool was we had five different states representing that weekend.
Whoa! So,
we had New Jersey, New York, Connecticut, Massachusetts, and Rhode Island? I want to say Rhode Island. Yeah. And I think we had almost like, I think we had like just about 50 people marching. Maybe a little, little shy of 50, but
yeah,
it was a good time.
Turnout.
Like we have a good time. A good and their commanding officer, Joe, is just great guy. So much fun to hang out with. We all went to dinner afterwards. And because, you know, when you're trooping and stuff, like, you're like on the clock, right, Todd? You know.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
So once
you're not hanging out with each other.
Yeah.
Like you all, but at the same time, it's like once the troop starts, it's like, all right, go, Todd.
Showtime.
Oh,
good
night. Yeah. Thank you. So we did the parade, and it was cold. It didn't rain though. That was the only thing because it kept like sprinkling a little bit every so often, and we all would just stop and go, God, no, please don't, like, not now, please. Yeah, but it's a pretty short parade. It's only like a mile and a half, I think, not even. If you've ever, I've never marched in a parade before this, and
what,
it's just, yeah, no, I've never.
Oh wow. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, we did it last year, but like this event was like my first like marching parade. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But man, like it's just funny when you're walking down the street, people like lose their minds over it. They're just and like I wore my Jin costume because the CEO of their base was wearing her Leia, and then another girl was wearing Rey. And I was like, my Jin, I don't put her on too often, you know? And it's felt like nobody knew who I was. It's just like, but it's, you know, it's fine. But no, I'll tell you one thing, that damn baby Yoda, you know, stealing all the spotlight because we had a Mando, right? And he had the satchel with little Grogu sticking out, and like they would see, you know, people see you walking up and they're like princess, because we had a Leia, a Luke, and a Han. We had like Vader, a Kylo, and Palpatine, like they were towards the front and everything. So you hear people get all excited for like 5 seconds, not even, all of a sudden they're like, it's just a doll in a bag. It's not even working. It's hell.
Oh no.
But anyway, yeah, we had a lot of fun. Got to hang out afterwards, had dinner. So we got to like talk more and, you know, get to know people more. And it's just a fun troop. And we all kind of come together in the Northeast. And yeah.
Yeah.
It's good times. So that was really my only big geeky thing, nerdy thing. Yeah.
Great. Glad to hear it. We lost Todd, unfortunately, but he wrote in, he has been playing Fortnite Mythos and Mortals. I think that's like a DLC for it or a season or something. Then Saturday, he watched Kung Fu Panda 4, Petland, and he had a bunch of pizza. Finished a book called Invisible College by Jacques Vallée. And AD After Disclosure by Bryce Zabel and Richard M. Dolan. I can only assume those are UFO conspiracy books based on his current reading habits.
His track record lately.
Yeah. So that is what Todd wrote in. For myself, Lee and I, this past weekend, we basically just had like a chill stay-in kind of weekend. And we watched a season each of two different TV shows. And we did it like hopscotch style. So like we'd watch an episode of one show and then follow that with the episode of the different show and then alternate back and forth. So, which was actually really cool because like you don't get burnt out on a show. Like one show serves as a palate cleanser for the other and vice versa. So the two shows we watched, The Clone Wars, which a way while back I mentioned watching like a fan edit of it that basically condenses down a bunch of the Clone Wars into like five seasons of 10 or so episodes each. So we've been watching through that. We just finished season 3. And then it's basically where the show actually starts to get like really good and like a consistent story instead of like these like isolated story arcs. So now Lee knows how terrible Pong Krell is. And there's like that weird like slavery episode. So like that's kind of the hinge, I think, of the show. And then the other show that we watched is called Alice in Borderland. Have you heard of this, Carla?
It sounds familiar.
Yeah, it's a Netflix series. And I guess it's kind of like Squid Game meets like Left Behind, which sounds very strange to say. But basically, it follows this like group of friends who they're just like normal people in Japan and just like, in an instant, like all the people from Tokyo disappear and there's like a handful of people left, and the people who are left, they have to go through these like weird escape room style games that usually if you make a big enough mistake during will just kill you. If you fail to complete the game, then it kills you. And if you succeed at the game, there's like a playing card assigned to the game that tells you the difficulty and like what type of game it is, and based on the number on the card, which is also like the difficulty of the game, it buys you like that many more days on your visa. And if your visa expires, then like a laser comes down from the sky and just like shoots you dead. So like you have to keep playing the games to stay alive.
What?
So fairly simple premise, simple story. It's very clear like what all the characters want, who they are, and it just kind of unfolds from there. I don't want to spoil it too much, but it's I think a good example of a show where it's not a complicated story, but it's just told very, very well and executed very well. The acting is phenomenal. They put those people through the ringer, but give great performances. I'm really digging it. We just finished the first season and we'll be moving on to the second one soon. So doing that, I'm working on a secret little project that I'll tell you about, Carla, after we get done recording.
Ooh, so confidential.
Not ready to reveal it just yet, but yeah, that's all I got for nerdy stuff for me for Cantina Chat. I almost forgot. So last night, I was trying to do, sorry, two nights ago, I was trying to do laundry, and before that, like, I come home, and, like, my internet just, like, extremely slow, it sucks, and it stops working, and there's, like, a service outage in my area, so I'm like, okay, I can't work on what I wanted to work on, so I guess I'll go do laundry, and then I get my laundry, I go down to the laundry room of my building, and it is on fire. There is
what?
Just smoke. Yeah, there's like smoke filling the room, and I'm like, this is bad. So I let the front desk know, and apparently they took care of it, but like I couldn't do my laundry. So I'm like, okay, no internet, can't do laundry. What am I gonna do?
The building is it's on like, fire.
I know, it's like 7:30, 8 o'clock. And I'm like, what am I going to do? So I dusted off my Nintendo 64 and played some GoldenEye.
Ooh, clutch.
Yeah. That was a nice, unexpected night of retro gaming.
Nice, so. Nice. Oh my gosh! Wait, so was like the dryer catch? I mean,
there weren't like open flames or anything like that. But one of the dryers like caught on fire. I don't know if it was like a belt that like wore out, or more likely like some lint caught on fire or something. I was flabbergasted to learn that some people never clean out the lint traps.
Yeah. That's dangerous, people.
Yeah.
Life hack.
Lint is extremely flammable.
Clean your lint filters.
Some people don't know there's a lint trap.
Ugh. Yeah, that's bad.
I had an English teacher in high school who was famous for saying, some people are too dumb to live. And back then, I thought that was pretty extreme, but...
That's accurate. I get it now.
Anyway, that's it.
Oh my gosh.
A smidge of nerdiness in a very bizarre evening. Okay, that's it for this episode. Thanks again for listening to WSTR. You can find us on the socials, myself at Aaron Julian, Carla at Carla Marie Giac, Heather at Hawk Awesome, Todd at Tizzod. We are part of the Red 5 Network, a wonderful network of Star Wars podcasts, so go check them out. You can find our back catalog of episodes at podcast.wstrmedia.com. We got merch over at store.wstrmedia.com, and we are on Patreon, patreon.com/wstrmedia. Thanks everybody for hanging out with us in the YouTube chat. You can head on over to livestream.wstrmedia.com to check that out. And if you want to reach us, mailbox@wstrmedia.com, or you can leave us a voicemail at 630-557-WSTR. That's 630-557-9787. Call us, leave a message, we'll get to it eventually. Next week, we are returning back to our ongoing series, Serious But Silly. Last time we talked about how do Twi'leks actually sleep with their Leku all up in their business, and we've got a similar serious but silly topic for next week, so you won't want to miss that. All right, Carla, there's only one way to end this show.
Now this is
podcasting.
Go read books.
And okay.